What is the ideal retaining system for your project? This is a very specific question. We can talk about aesthetics and architecture, but in this video, I will just assume you are here because you are building on a tight budget. Let's start with the question, why you would need a retaining wall? Well, you might be building your house on a sloping ground and you need to cut and fill the side so you can have a flat surface to build the pad of your house. That means you will need a retaining wall on the cut side and also one on the fill side. Or you may want to cut a sloping ground next to your place so you can have a space to install a trampoline for the kids and also a pool on the other side. The way I would choose a retaining wall is based on the soil type. It could be clay, sand, silt, rock, or a mix of them all. The height to be retained, the space I have available, and the logistics of the works. In other words, if there is access for machines. The more area available, the cheapest the retaining wall will be. And I'll explain you why now. Firstly, the cheapest material you can get is the one already existing on your site, and that is the soil itself. So if you have sufficient space, you can cut the slope at the soil angle of repose, which is the angle where the soil will hold itself. And this angle is generally between 25 and 45 degrees for clay and sand. And voila, your retaining wall is actually the soil itself. It cannot get cheaper than that. The second cheapest option is not exactly a wall, but a system that can be built with different types of walls. I'll let this one for the end of the video because we're gonna go through the types of walls that can be used in this system and it will be easier to understand. Jumping to the third option, they are the gravity walls. These types of walls rely on their self-weight for stability. Here we have a boulder wall, a gabion wall, or a crib wall. The lateral earth pressure tries to overturn and slide the wall. And at the same time, the self-weight of the structure is counteracting these forces to keep the system stable. Again, area available might be a problem with this system. Walls over 4 meters high will require a really wide basis, which might be impracticable. Besides that, since they are really heavy structures, the soil under the wall must have reasonable bearing capacity. In terms of cost of materials, you can use a gabion wall, which is a steel wire cage filled with rocks. You can use boulders, and then if you use masonry blocks or concrete, it gets a little bit more expensive. If you choose a concrete gravity wall, you will need formwork, and all these things will add up to the final cost of the project. The fourth option would be a timber sleeper retaining wall, which could be as cheap as the previous solution. However, I would only use this type of retaining walls for landscaping, like garden walls or just a feature wall. The height limit is around 1.5 meters and they will last approximately 15 years or more, depending on the timber treatment. If you're looking for something similar that will last longer, you can go for a concrete sleeper retaining wall. This system is comprised of concrete sleepers spanning horizontally between steel posts, which are cast into a board pier. It's one of the thinnest retaining walls you can get if your goal is to maximize the use of your land, and you can possibly go as high as 6 meters if you use a really robust design. But just remember, the higher you go, the deeper the board piers need to go. Therefore, if you're on a rocky side, for example, it might be impracticable to dig holes deep enough. In terms of engineering, the lateral earth pressure will put the concrete sleepers into bending, which in turn will transfer these forces to the UB or UC steel posts. These posts cantilever out of a concrete board pier, which should be embedded deep enough into the soil to resist the bending moment by passive pressure. The steel posts can go all the way down the board piers, or a cheaper option would be lapping the steel posts with reinforcement. The next option is reinforced concrete masonry cantilever retaining wall. This system consists of a reinforced concrete footing which anchors the wall against overturning and sliding, and a stem of concrete masonry blocks. The stem is reinforced with steel bars placed vertically to resist bending moment, and horizontal bars for cracking control. All blocks are filled with a semi-fluid concrete known as grout. Walls over 2.2 meters high will require a portion of the stem to be 209 wide blocks. And for walls over 4 meters high, we would be looking to add some sort of buttresses or counterforts spaced a length equal or less than the wall height. Depending on the side that your property is located, you might have the heel extended under the soil, or you might have the toe extended in front of the stem. Usually having the heel extended under the soil is preferable, as the weight of the soil will help to prevent overturning and sliding. On the other hand, if the toe extends in front of the stem, there's no soil to counteract the overturning and sliding forces. Therefore, depending on the height of the wall and type of soil, you might have to build a base key to prevent sliding. This wall is designed as a cantilever beam fixed to the concrete footing. You will have to check for overturning, sliding, and soil bearing pressure. Reinforced concrete masonry basement walls are also another good use for concrete blocks. So let's imagine you're building a concrete slab on top of a retaining wall, and this concrete slab might be able to restrain the top of the wall and prevent movement. So now the wall is designed as a simply supported beam instead of a cantilever, and we can use a strip footing instead of a large typical retaining wall footing. You will have to ensure that the base and top slab can transfer the reactions and really restrain the system. A timber floor, for instance, might not be able to restrain the top of the wall. Another important point to consider with basement wall is that they need to be propped until the concrete slab has achieved its full strength. In the case you cannot prop the wall, you're better off designing a normal cantilever retaining wall. By the way, guys, I'm putting together another ebook where I go through the actual design of some of these retaining walls, step by step, a complete design, you know, footings and everything else. So stay tuned and I'll let you know when it's ready. And finally, the second option that I left for the end of the video, which is not exactly a wall, but a series of walls. They are the tiered walls or cascading walls. In this system, the walls will be stacked one behind another. So instead of building a single super high wall, which could be quite intimidating in a normal environment, you would be building a series of small walls. Again, space could potentially be an issue, especially because there needs to be a minimum distance from wall to wall so that the walls above do not surcharge the walls below. Otherwise, you will have to design these walls below to take the extra loads. And let's use some numbers to understand why this system might be more advantageous. When we work out the lateral earth pressure, we know that the load increases uniformly from top to bottom, forming a triangle, and the pressure is the density of the soil times the earth pressure coefficient K times the height of the wall. The bending moment diagram for a cantilever beam subjected to triangular loading is a curve like this one, and the maximum bending moment is given by W squared divided by 6. That means W times the height of the wall squared divided by 6. If we substitute W for the lateral earth pressure, the factor height is now to the power of 3. In other words, if we double the height of the wall, the bending moment we need to design this wall for will be multiplied by 8, which means more material and larger structural elements in the project. Anyway, this was just a fun way that I wanted to show you that you can actually analyze prices by running simple equations. Obviously, you would have to have a chat with your contractor and confirm the actual costs behind building an extra wall. But in terms of engineering, the numbers don't lie, and it would be cheaper. There are a lot more types of retaining walls out there. A few of them I didn't mention in this video because they require a more specialized design, and they're usually more expensive and not worth it for smaller projects. Thanks again for watching. If you learned something new here, give the video a like and subscribe to the channel, and I will see you next time.